So with that, we are finally where we wanted to go, which is restricted Boltzmann machines. I think we have all the background material ready now, and we can now start discussing restricted Boltzmann machines. So we return back to our Markov network containing hidden variables and visible variables, and everything that is written on the first bullet, we understand Markov network, we understand what are hidden variables, we understand what are visible variables, and how they connect with each other to form this Markov network. Okay, and we'll get rid of the image. We'll get rid of this image from the background, and we'll just focus on the random variables that we care about, which are all these n visible variables and m hidden variables. Right? So I'll just okay. We have changed this. This is n and m. I think at one place we'll have to change it. Right? I hope this doesn't create confusion, but there are n of one and m of the other. Okay. And as someone said, this is a bipartite graph. So we have edges between each pair of hidden comma visible variables. We do not have edges between hidden comma hidden variables and visible comma visible variables. Okay. Earlier we saw that given such a Markov network, given such a means any in the Markov network, you could actually get the joint probability distribution by writing it as a product of the factors. What are the factors in this particular Markov network? One factor corresponding to what was the key term there? We have factors corresponding to everyone, maximal cliques. What are the maximal cliques here? Just edges, right? I mean, just two nodes form a maximal clique. So how many factors will you have? M cross n, right? So correspond to maximal cliques. The maximal cliques in this case are just every pair of random hidden comma this variable. So you'll have m cross n factors, and this is how you can write it, right? For every visible variable, for every hidden variable, you will have a factor which captures their interaction. Okay. This is not, this particular factor is not a conditional probability distribution. It just tells us the strength of the interaction between them. And then why do we have Z? Normalization, so that we make it a probability distribution. Okay. Okay. And let's just remember that this belongs to 2 raised to m. This belongs to 2 raised to n. Okay. Fine. Yeah. Now we can also add additional factors. At this point, can anyone guess why I have added these two factors? What are these two factors? Corresponding to visible variables and corresponding to hidden variables, right? Why have I added these factors? First of all, is it legal to add these factors? We said that the factors have to be maximal cliques. It's desirable to have maximal cliques. It's not that we can have anything which is, we cannot have anything which is less than a maximal clique, right? So you could think of each of these independent nodes and add factors for them. Why would I be doing this? You'll have to go to the normal route, right? If you want to learn, say, VI, you'll have to take P of V comma H and then marginalize over everything else and so on, right? So it doesn't mean that you just take this and say that this is P of VI, right? That's not correct, right? You see that? Right. So there's a specific reason why we have this, and we'll get to that. So first of all, let's understand this is legal to do this, that as long as I ensure that my partition function is such that the whole thing gets normalized and I get a probability distribution, I can add these factors. It's not wrong to do that, okay? I have factors corresponding to maximal cliques, and I've also decided to add additional factors to my graphical model, right? So that's perfectly fine to do that. And notice that this partition function is actually very complex. So what do I mean by summation V? How many elements are there in this summation? Is this a vector, scalar? So that's very important you understand what summation V means. How many terms does that summation have? It means sum over all possible V's, right? So this is actually summation all V's belonging to capital V. And how many such V's do we have? How many? M. We have M such V's. I asked you what V is. You said V is a vector. And then you're telling me there are M such vectors. How many of you say M? Now how many of you can give me the right answer? 2 power m. So, I have to give you a wrong answer to get the right answer. So, 2 power m, right? This is all possible outcomes in your. So, what does the denominator typically do in probability? It considers all possible outcomes. What are all possible outcomes? All possible values for the vector v. How many such values do we have? The entire space, which is 2 raised to m. What about the second summation? 2 raised to n, right? So, this is a summation over an exponential number of terms. So, z is a problem, right? This factorization and all is fine to write, but still this is intractable because of this denominator which will have to go over an exponential number of terms. At some point, we will have to handle this, that this denominator either gets out of the scene or it becomes tractable. One way or the other, we will have to handle this, right? Is that fine? Okay. So, let us understand each of these factors in more detail. For example, if you have the factor phi 1 1, which essentially captures the interactions between v 1 comma h 1, what will this factor actually give you? What will it take as input and what will it give to you as output? What will it take as input? The values of v 1 and h 1. How many such values are possible? 4, 2 cross 2. For each of these 4 configurations, it will give you one value. So, what is this phi 1 1 actually? It's a table, right? Very similar to the conditional probability distribution table, where you have to have a value for all possible configurations of the two variables, right? So, we could have a table like this and it could have some affinities in it and that will give us some values, okay? Similarly, what would psi v 1 be? It will take one of these two possible values, which is 0 or 1. And it will give you a output for that, right? So, psi v 1 could be this small, okay. So, we have this psi 1 and you could have a similar argument for the zetas also, right? So, you will have this zeta 1 also, which looks something similar, which takes on one of the two possible values for each random variable and then gives you. How many of these tables do you have in your joint distribution? Everyone? How many of these tables do you have? M. And how many of zetas? Now that I know it is called zeta, okay. Okay, so, just to be sure that we completely understand it, so let us take a very small example where we have v equal to 3 and h equal to 2 and again both of them 0 to 1 r raised to 3 and 0 to 1 raised to 2. Okay. So, this is what we have. Now, suppose we are interested in p of v equal to 0 0 0 and h equal to 1 1, how is this probability going to be computed? I have given you all the factors, right? We always assume that there is some oracle which gives us things. How are you going to compute this value? First, you will write it down as a product, right? So, these are all the factors in your product. To each of these factors, you will supply the right configuration, right? So, to the first factor, you will supply 0, 1, second factor again 0, 1 and so on. And to the individual factors, you will assign pass 0, 0, 1, 1 and so on, right? Whatever are the values that you have taken for these particular random variables, you will plug in those values into the factors, look up the table, get those values and then you have this hard job, and now this should be clear that this goes over all possible values of all the random variables, right? That is why this was exponential, right? This is 2 raised to 3, this is 2 raised to 2, okay? So, you will compute the partition function also by plugging in all possible configurations and finally, you will get the value. Now, how do we learn these clique potentials? Finally, getting to the question. Whenever we want to learn something, neural networks, the sum total of the course is 0. Whenever you want to learn something, what do we introduce? Parameters, right? So, what will we have to introduce? We will have to introduce a parametric form for these factors, okay? So, we will introduce a parametric form and the specific parametric form that we are going to consider is the following. We are going to say that psi of vi comma hj is equal to e raised to, not this is not psi, this is phi, okay, vi into hj into some weight associated with that. So, what is the parameter now? Wij. So, I learn this parameter in a way that some objective function is satisfied. I do not know what that objective function yet is, but I will have to learn that so that a certain objective function is satisfied. And I have introduced parameters, okay? Now these are VIs, and I have introduced CJ and HJ. Is that fine? This is again my modeling choice. This is how I have decided the factors should be. I could have chosen any other factors also. I could have said that actually it should be VI transpose. No, that doesn't make sense. It's a single thing, right? So I could have chosen some other parametric form also, right? Which is not necessarily a linear parametric form, right? It did not be Wij into Vij. I could have chosen anything. This is the modeling assumption which I make, that this is how my model looks like. This is what the parametric form is. Now let's see what's the implication of this particular choice. So this is what our joint distribution looks like. Now I'll substitute all these parameters into it. What will I get? A product of many exponentials, right? So this is what I'll get. Okay. And the product of exponentials I can write as exponential of sums. Is that fine? Have you ever seen this kind of an equation before? Where? Oh, you have seen it in the assignment. I thought you'll say it in the course. Have you ever seen this in the course before? What is this? Looks very similar to, it's very similar to the form Wx plus b plus c, isn't it? Right? Okay. So now I can write, I'm going to write this as the following. It's e raised to minus of some function of v and h. It's right to write that because this is actually a function of v and h, right? All the v's and h's are contributing to that, right? And where this function, which is called the energy function, is nothing but the negative of this sum that you see here. It's just some trickery to make the notation simple and make it consistent with something else in the literature. Okay? So I have come up with a form which depends on v, h, and the energy, this is known as the energy function, and I'll tell you why. The energy function is actually given by this, and the probability distribution is a function of this energy function given by this. Everyone clear with this? This is some trickery to arrange the terms and come up with this neat form where the energy function is a linear function of some weights and your variables. Is that fine? Okay. If the energy is high, the probability would be low or high? Low. If the energy is low, high, because there's a negative, right? E raised to minus of energy. So if the energy is high, it will go into the denominator. So it's okay, that's fine. Okay. High energy, low probability. Low energy, high probability. Okay. Have you seen this any time before? Okay. So because of the above form, we refer to these networks as restricted Boltzmann machines. Why restricted? Why restricted? This everyone should answer. Because we allow for only, remember the naive Bayes model? Now tell me why restricted? Because of all the possible connections, you could have had a complete graph, right? Where every V is connected to every V, every H is connected to every H. You have restricted the number of connections, you have made it a bipartite graph, and you have only allowed certain types of connections. Hence restricted. Why Boltzmann? Why Boltzmann? So this comes from actually statistical mechanics, where the distribution of particles in the system is given by this distribution, right? That a state is, the probability of a state is proportional to something of this form, where E is the energy in that state, right? And we have a very similar form here, and that's why this is known as the Boltzmann distribution or the Gibbs distribution. Okay, so we have, what we have done is we have taken our Markov network, which was well motivated from the image example that the pixels actually come from some latent variables, and now we have made it possible to learn this distribution by introducing certain factors. The factors were very carefully chosen, which led to a certain form of the probability distribution, which was of this form, e raised to minus of the energy, where the energy function was given by this, which looks very similar to a neural network because it's WX plus B. Okay. So that's where we have finally reached restricted Boltzmann machines. And now the question which I need to answer is, which is still not very clear, why are we doing this in a course on deep learning, right? What's the connection to neural networks, right? So we need to look at that. So we have restricted Boltzmann machines. We still are looking at it as a graphical model where you have certain sets of random variables and certain interactions and certain factors, but we still don't know why this is a neural network. So that's what we look at next. Why are RBMs neural networks? Okay.